59 at Radio Free America, and this is Uncle Sam with Music and the Truth Until Dawn. Right now, I've got a few words for some of our brothers and sisters in the occupied zone. The chair is against the wall. The chair is against the wall. John has a long mustache. John has a long mustache. It's 12 o'clock, Americans, another day closer to victory. And for all of you out there on or behind the lines, this is your song.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to
I have a joke for you.
Okay.
The government in this town is excellent and uses your tax dollars efficiently.
Bitcoin is immune from attack almost completely. With Bitcoin, you actually gain far more from using that computing power to generate Bitcoin.
There's a system approaching perfection. Just in time for our disappearance. There's a system approaching perfection. Just in time for our disappearance.
We'll walk deeper into the belly of the beast if it means I'm able to further limit reckless government spending. I mean, I have so many ideas. Some are simple, like take down traffic lights and eliminate the post office. The bigger ones will be tougher, like bring all of this crumbling to the ground.
And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is The Crypto Show, a show dedicated to understanding the promise of currency, technology, and anarchy in the pursuit of a free society. And if you believe like we do that such a society can and should exist, then join us, why don't you, as we parade through a world unbound by convention, a world sketched by the beauty of the human artist. Because each and every one of you listening right now, unless you're a reptilian, is that artist. So for the next 2 hours, let go of your most sacred system of thought and entertain the possibility that maybe, just maybe, everything we've been told about currency, technology, reptilians, and yes, even that dirty, dirty little word, anarchy, is only one part of an ever-expanding, ever-possible, complex universe of ideas, one that we simply refuse to explore. So what do you say, reptilians, let's do some universe exploring tonight and have some fun while we do it.
That's a short one, isn't it?
That was short, but
that was
sweet.
Longer.
Did y'all see what I did there?
I saw the head drop.
Subliminally inserting a certain word. And trust me on this, I'm not playing with you.
Not the star date, the real date.
Captain's log, star date 52436.7. Mr. Spock. It is October 11th, 2015, live from New York. It's Sunday night. here on the Crypto Show. And of course, if you've been following us at all, we had a live airing of the show yesterday from 3 to 5 Central Standard Time here in New York at the New York Liberty Fest in the heart of Williamsburg, Brooklyn, New York City, New York. And this was the first trip to New York for me or Danny, and it was quite a fun adventure. And we got to meet a lot of cool new people. We got to meet a lot of people that we already knew. And we got some guests here on the show today whom we've all, I believe, had before on the show, except for one, actually. But, I've just gotten so close to the guy over this weekend that I feel like he's been on the show many times. And he's a cool guy, and I'll leave that a mystery for just the moment. But it's going to be an exciting show. We also produced some pre-recorded podcasts that we did with some special guests, including Carlos Morales of LibertarianAtheist.com and James Blanchard of
Anthem Vault.
I'm sorry, Anthem Blanchard of Anthem Vault.
Hayek Gold.
And Hayek Gold. So check that out. On the website, cryptoshow.com, thecryptoshow.com. And don't forget about thecryptoshow.com/FreeRoss, where you can still donate directly to the Free Ross Ulbricht Appeals Fund and also purchase from the cryptoshow.com website some really cool stuff, all of the proceeds of which go directly to the Ross Ulbricht Appeals Fund. So be sure to help Ross. You know, as someone pointed out this weekend during the talks at the Liberty Fest, as we've pointed out before, as many others have pointed out, Bitcoin arguably would not have any value, or at least
would have not nearly as much value, adoption, or acceptance if it weren't for things like the Silk Road, started by Ross Ulbricht, who really gave Bitcoin a lot of life and a lot of use.
As well as Satoshi Dice.
Of course. And I've lost so much Bitcoin on that website. No, I'm just kidding. But anyway, it's going to be a great show. So my guests today, we're going to have three guests. We usually have one or two, but these guys were too important and too cool not to cram into one episode. And we're not going to have the opportunity to have them on for a little bit. It's certainly not in person. We're here with them physically in the room. It's exciting. We have Paul Puey, whose name I've actually been mispronouncing for a long time, but only subtly. No one ever noticed it. I don't even think Paul did. He is the CEO.
I intentionally didn't correct you so you would look silly.
You're such a douche, and that's probably true. I hate when people do that. It's easy enough for me to make myself look like an idiot, but then people facilitate it like you. But Paul Puey.
I'm not even going to tell you the part about the food, but go ahead.
Oh God, are you talking about the pretzel yesterday or the day before? Anyway, Paul Puey, CEO, founder of AirBitz, which is a really cool Bitcoin wallet, great for beginners and experts alike. And it's more than just a Bitcoin wallet. It has a Bitcoin directory of over, I think, 10,000 merchants. Is that right, Paul?
Breaking about 6,000 or
That's
so.
That's still an incredible number of merchants. So we're going to talk to him. We also have Dimitry Rasa. I got that right? Okay. Dimitry is the main representative. What is your official title?
I am currently a product manager for the wallet.
Product manager for Mycelium wallet, which is a alternative wallet out there, a great one as well out there with AirBitz. And we're really excited to talk to both of them respectively about their wallets that they represent and also to have a little bit of dialogue.
This is basically the 2015 Wallet Smackdown Battle Royale. We're going to find out who has the best wallet.
And
I think we're going to find this out by making them arm wrestle, and the winner of the arm wrestling contest has a better wallet.
Oh, yeah. Dimitri Rasa of Mycelium, Paul Puey of AirBitz, and we're also really excited to have Tone Vays of Brave New Coin here with us. Tone, how are you?
Thanks, guys. I'm doing great.
No, Tone, actually, thank you. We are actually coming live from Tone's place. It's a really cool pad. Around New York City. I don't want to maybe be too specific for anonymity purposes. But Tone is gracious enough to let us do this here, and he's been very hospitable. And he's a great he's a Bitcoin analyst and a financial analyst, and who has a lot of experience in the financial world. And we're going to talk to him here in a bit, too. And Tone, of course, do we have an extra mic for all three of them to do at once?
No, but I can hand mine over.
Okay. Well, Tone, we're gonna focus on them at first, but if you have anything to chip in, definitely feel free to do that, and then we'll talk to you more directly too later on in the show.
Yeah. No. Thanks. I'm sure these guys will we'll take care of it.
definitely. These guys will take care of it because Danny certainly won't. Danny doesn't take care of anything.
I will say that these are my two favorite wallets. They're actually the two wallets that I use, so I'm more than happy to house them anytime during New York.
Well, that's nice of you. And they're not just great wallets, they're great guys. And that's a ringing endorsement from a guy like Tone Vays. He's got a lot of great analysis and knowledge of the Bitcoin sphere, so that's quite a statement.
I don't know who I'm going to be embarrassing, you or me, but I've known him for over a year, and I still don't know whether the E in the name is silent.
Tone.
Is it Tony or Tone?
It's Tone.
It's short for toenail. Okay.
Exactly. Well, I guess we're going to learn some more intimate details about each other while we're here in this room for the next hour and a half. So hopefully that personal knowledge isn't too scary or creepy. But we're coming to break in about 3 minutes, but we're going to go ahead and start things off. And in no particular order, or really I should say, only because he's directly to my right and not showing any preference, we're going to talk to Paul Puey, CEO of AirBitz. And Paul has been on the show many times. Paul, what have you... That's many times, I think.
Yeah, I guess twice is pretty cool.
Twice? No, it's been like three or four times.
It's been three or four times, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. I'm insulted.
Wow. I think twice from while I was in San Diego.
Twice from San Diego, okay. But yeah. Then again at the Texas Bitcoin.
We had a few recordings.
Yeah. Yeah. A few. Cool.
The Texas Bitcoin Conference as well.
Yes, that's the one I was thinking of.
He's like the guy who goes out with you a couple times and then just never calls you back. Man.
Let's,
you know. Anyway, moving on from making it weird. Our listeners, our regular listeners have probably heard
you. We're from Austin, so we're supposed to keep it weird for some reason. I don't know.
That's right.
I don't know why they just make us. But Paul, give us a quick background about yourself.
My name is Paul Puey, CEO and co-founder of AirBitz, and I've got a background that kind of spans many different industries. Starting in the technology space, I graduated with an electrical engineering degree and worked in Silicon Valley for NVIDIA, did some visual computing, drivers, whatnot, low-level software, and as well, website design, web dev, but also worked in small business. I was that guy behind the counter getting reamed by credit card fees, dealing with chargebacks, dealing with the junky software that point of sale systems that small businesses run, and this is kind of a full circle experience now, kind of combining technology and financial systems and systems that small businesses use.
That's something really that everybody needs to work on is that point of sale issue.
Because
I've had several gas stations that have almost talked into accepting Bitcoin, but we couldn't integrate the point of sale.
No, exactly. We had someone that wants to build a gas station specific point of sale because their usage is so specific. Mm-hmm. And there were some issues with Bitcoin with, having to prepay, then get the change and blah, blah, blah.
And the thing that's so attractive about that for a gas station is there's a very small margin of profit on top of the gas. So they're really almost losing all their profit to credit
card. To the credit card fees. That's a really good point.
So they've got the most amazing food marts because that's where they make all their money. You swing by, you basically get, they lose out on the gas, but you go buy a whole bunch of Slurpees.
And you pay twice as much for the cheap ham sandwich that you get than you would from the store.
Exactly.
Well, we're coming to break, and I just want to comment, Paul, that that's what I like about you, among other things, is that not only are you a sharp guy with a great company and product, but you're sort of vertically integrated, if you will, compared to a lot of people. Like you said, you've got the technology experience, some of the finance and business in the front end, and that's a good combination. But we'll talk to him and Dimitri and Tone when we get back. Stay tuned after the break.
Tomorrow, are you a leader or will you follow? Are you a fighter or will you cower? It's our time to take back the power. What's your plan for tomorrow? Are you a leader or will you follow? Are you a fighter or will you cower? It's our time to take back the power. What you gonna do when they show up in black suits on your street?
All right, guys, welcome back to the Crypto Show here on this lovely Sunday, October 11, 2015, in the aftermath, the bloody aftermath of Liberty Fest NYC in the heart of Brooklyn, Williamsburg, Brooklyn, New York City. Actually, we're not technically there anymore. We're still in New York City or around there. But we're talking to Paul Puey, CEO and founder of AirBitz, Dimitry Rasa of Mycelium, and Tone Vays, a Bitcoin and financial expert. And just got a little bit of background information on Paul, but we're going to have Paul tell us just what AirBitz is all about. Go ahead, Paul.
Oh, wow. What is it all about? There's so many things that have brought our company together and our passions. Our passion starts off obviously with Bitcoin, but making not just Bitcoin, but the core fundamentals of it, which are the ability for us to have control over our own data, our own value, is a pretty strong value proposition. So what Bitcoin does for money, AirBitz as a company is trying to do for all types of data, starting with Bitcoin. So we can hold our own value, we can send it without a third party to other people, and also have that aspect of privacy. So we've built our wallet with the concept of zero knowledge. Like, we as a company don't see transactions. We as a company don't have access to people's funds. We as a company don't see any of the metadata that people can add to a transaction, who they paid, who they received money from, notes, categories, and all that kind of stuff. And what we've really wanted to do is take that platform that's underneath the covers, that the mobile app, the iOS app and the Android app is built on top of. That platform is actually a cross-platform software library that can be used for almost any application. It could be a financial application like a Quicken QuickBooks. It could be health record application. It could be secure chat application that's holding private keys, or it could be any blockchain application like an Augur or any other Ethereum app that needs to secure private keys or any other data. So what we're trying to build is, you know, our value system that we put into Bitcoin, we want other developers to start to adopt. But the challenges are that the tools aren't really there for developers to create apps that don't divulge user information, right? We've been so focused on the cloud, put everything on the cloud, and then try to secure those servers, which is nearly impossible. Just like it's impossible to secure banks, right? You just get hacked and you buy lots of insurance, you pay a lot of money. In the same sense, it's impossible to secure servers that have high values of data. So we've developed a platform, we call it Edge Security, which is you secure the edges of the network. You secure the devices that people own. You don't rely on the security of the channels by which you communicate. You don't rely on the security of the servers that are holding the data. You secure the data before it ever leaves the device. And so that to us makes it gives a potential for not just, oh, great, Bitcoin's a great tool for privacy and security. No, it creates an entire ecosystem by which apps can be built and provide the same level of privacy and security as we're trying to build into AirBitz and Bitcoin. And it actually can be a full ecosystem where, you know, your credentials that get you into your AirBitz app can also authenticate you with various websites, can also authenticate you with other apps that have some of your private data.
That's really cool. And we've had on Chris Odom of Open Transactions, and he kind of talks about this principle a lot, where it's like you are, you know, if you rely on security and rely on a third party, even if the risk is relatively low, the risk is still there. And you're risking very valuable stuff, whether it's your personal information, your Bitcoin private keys, or what have you. And so if you can secure that on your own end, that's such a much more advantageous situation than a lot of the stuff that's available out there right now.
Absolutely. We like to say that security is only good enough when you apply security by technology. And so that's just throwing all of the technology weapons at, you know, your data. But then there's also the aspect of security, what we call security by game theory. So you have to build a system whereby the incentive is significantly reduced to hack the system. So someone might still be able to, but the incentives are reduced because the rewards are reduced. And by securing data at the edges, meaning that you have to hack individual devices, and you only get the information or the value that's on that device for a significant amount of effort, then the interest level of hacking that system goes down. Well, why not just hack a central server that then, once I'm able to get through the doors, I get access to everything that's on there. Exactly. You know, so that model to me is important, and people need to be thinking about the incentive behind their security model in addition to the actual technology. And so many security companies think about just the technology. Let's throw piles and piles of steel-plated walls on top of our servers, but they don't think about the incentive.
Right. No, and that's a really good point is, like you said, if you can get the big jackpot all at once, even if it's difficult, well, you have a strong incentive to try and crack that. But if you're just getting like sort of a pittance of information here and there, and it's really intensive, and then you don't even know where you're necessarily looking to get the next one through another device or what have you, it makes it a lot more difficult. I like that. It's sort of decentralizing further the risk, I guess, or the reward data. Too, the data, the obviously. Value. Yeah, yep. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah. One of the biggest challenges, I think, like people ask, well, why haven't we been doing this? And so one of the biggest challenges with technology that can do edge security and zero knowledge applications is that because you're now allowing the users to hold and control the data, just like we say, okay, well, you can hold and control your own private keys in Bitcoin. Now we have to tell users that, well, you're responsible for it. You need to apply all of the technologies that secure the data, that back up the data, encrypt it, protect it from yourself as well. And so all of those technologies have been very hard to use and have been relegated to IT managers, technology people.
Basically experts.
Experts,
not accessible to your average
They're general, not accessible. Yeah. So what we're trying to do is take that platform, you know, and allow people to build more apps that kind of feel like AirBitz and that, you know, that username and password, automatically encrypt the data, automatically backs it up, and automatically synchronizes it and protects it with nearly invisible, what we call one-touch two-factor, and has data rollback, so in case data gets corrupted, you can roll it back to a previous version. All of those point technologies, which many companies focus on the point technologies, but no one's kind of come together and brought it together as a package. When you bring it together as a package and you offer it kind of under the covers, now people can take advantage of all of those without even knowing it.
Yeah, and you love that phrase, under the covers.
Oh, man. It's kind of chilly here in New York, and so, you know.
Well, it is. You got to keep warm, I understand.
Warm fuzzies. That's what we want to deliver to the masses.
Exactly.
Warm
that's
fuzzy
all,
feeling.
That's all the masses want is warm fuzzies, you know.
Oh, yeah.
A vague feeling of satisfaction.
Exactly.
And AirBitz delivers that. No, and that's what I like about AirBitz, and you've had this consistent philosophy, which, of course, feeds into the technology aspect of it, is a balance of security and privacy and usability. And, you know, that seems to have been the core sort of message and goal. I mean, correct?
No, absolutely. We try to balance all of them. That's a very hard thing to do. And I can't say that we're doing it exactly right. We're taking our best guess.
It's an art as much as science.
It is. It's analyzing what people want, need, and really care about. And we start from a usability point of view. And arguably, there are more private solutions than what we've built. And there's more absolutely bulletproof security than what we've built. But we start from the most private and secure thing that we can make very usable, and we start adding more functionality that gives better privacy and better security underneath the covers where users don't even know it's happening,
right?
And increase that value, but while still retaining the same level of usability. Like, we added the one touch two factor, and that almost was instant and nearly invisible, retaining the same level of usability. And we have other things that are in the roadmap and pipeline to add better layers of privacy and security. But really, it's not just about making it usable. It's actually about making it invisible.
I like that. That's well put. Well, and, you know, and we talked about how, you know, your average person isn't an expert in all these things that can make their data and their Bitcoin or what have you secure. But what they do need to become, though, is mini experts. And what I mean is they need to be sort of met halfway by companies like AirBitz that give them the sort of technology that's more accessible to them that still takes maybe a slight learning curve or a slight bit of time to sort of master, but not so much obviously that you have to become a computer expert.
Exactly.
But still, it's important, and this was talked about even in the Liberty Fest conference by, I know Julia Taransky brought this up, probably someone else, which is the fact that we need to be more responsible for ourselves and for our own security.
Exactly.
And data. And that's not even just some like individualist libertarian philosophy thing. That's one, always been the case. Like, people adapt and thrive and survive better when they learn to be responsible for themselves rather than having someone else do it and shielding them for reality. Mm-hmm. But then also the technology is leading in that direction. With stuff like Bitcoin, with stuff that's peer-to-peer decentralized, it's incumbent upon the average person who wants to go into this world, and this world is ultimately inevitable, so there's no sort of avoiding it in the long run. You're going to have to learn how to secure your data and your Bitcoin and what have you. And luckily, we have companies like AirBitz providing these tools for us. We've got about 45 seconds till break. And I think on the other side, I'm going to give Dimitry a chance to talk about his company and his wallet. But in the 40 seconds that we have, Paul, when is the rollout for some of the stuff you were just talking about, the edge security?
So our platform is open source. It's a licensable open source, so people can actually go to GitHub and give it a shot. It's just not well documented and well architected for many different platforms that people would be developing on. But people can use it today. It's still morphing, but our rollout is expected in for second quarter of 2016.
That's pretty quick, second quarter of 2016. So be anticipating that. In the meantime, you can still use AirBitz. It's still a very wonderful wallet and directory to use. We'll be right back with Dimitry, Rasa, and the rest here on The Crypto Show.
The plaintiff or defendant in a lawsuit? Win your case without an attorney with Jurisdictionary, the affordable, easy-to-understand 4-CD course that will show you how in 24 hours, step by step. If you have a lawyer, know what your lawyer should be doing. If you don't have a lawyer, know what you should do for yourself. Thousands have won with our step-by-step course, and now you can too. Jurisdictionary was created by a licensed attorney with 22 years of case-winning experience. Even if you're not in a lawsuit, you can learn what everyone should understand about the principles and practices that control our American courts. You'll receive our audio classroom, video seminar, tutorials, forms for civil cases, pro se tactics, and much more. Please visit ruleoflawradio.com and click on the banner or call toll-free 866-LAW-EASY.
We'll be right back.
All right, guys, welcome back to the Crypto Show here on Logos Radio Network, brought to you, as always, by Brave New Books and Hill Country Home Improvements. On this lovely Sunday, October 11, 2015, on the other end of the New York City Liberty Fest in New York, where we still are coming to you live, and we'll be coming back into Austin, hopefully soon. We're going to be up all night, probably. But anyway, we're talking to Paul Puey of AirBitz, Dimitry Rasa of Mycelium, and Tone Vays, financial Bitcoin and risk analyst. And we're going to switch over to Dimitry here in just a moment, but I do want to wrap up with Paul, and we'll have some dialogue between them too, and maybe some questions that address to both of them, and then we'll get to Tone. But Paul, we just want to add, just for clarification, with when I talked about the rollout, all this edge security is already implemented into the AirBitz wallet. It's a matter of rolling it out to be for the tools to be accessible to other developers, correct?
Yes, absolutely. So the AirBitz wallet has been using this platform and hardening the platform over the course of the past, you know, year or so that we've been developing it, and it's already in use by our wallet. So we are the first application on our own edge security platform. And so our goal now is to better document it, harden the language by which you can talk to this platform to achieve all of the data security, and then roll that out, like I said, first second quarter of 2016. But developers are already welcome to use it. So it's there. It's on GitHub, AirBitz. GitHub.com/AirBitz, and they can start giving us feedback on it, try it, use it. So it is available, but what we're excited about is definitely getting it out into the hands of other developers and working with other teams.
Right, and that's the beauty of decentralization and the market is, you know, the more heads you get on it, you throw at it, the better it can become, and that's the beauty of open source. Well, real quick, one last thing, too. It looks like there may be an added feature coming to AirBitz. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so being added to our platform, we found that one of the biggest requests in the community was, you know, heck, I like the wallet, I'm onboarding people with it, but how do I actually get Bitcoin? And we're having to direct people to more centralized services that hold Bitcoin in order to buy Bitcoin. So we're integrating into our app.
Do you mean those ones that make you wait a week to get your Bitcoin?
You know, I can't. They do make you wait a week, but I forgive them for that because that's the interface with the legacy banking system. That's not necessarily something that's in their
point.
Control.
Yeah.
I forgive them for that. What I don't forgive them for is holding other people's Bitcoin and claiming to be a wallet versus a bank.
Yeah, that's
so what
point.
We're trying to do is eliminate that and actually give people full control of the Bitcoin in the entire process of buying it. So we're linking inside of our mobile app, getting directly linked to various third-party exchanges around the world.
Under the covers.
Under the covers. and allowing people to buy and sell Bitcoin, which ends up directly inside of the AirBitz wallet and keys that they control and sends directly from that wallet to these exchanges and money appears in their bank account or at ATMs. And we're excited about this because we can roll out in many different countries through partnerships versus us trying to do everything ourselves. And so we're in a way decentralizing access to buy-sell services.
That's cool. You're just sort of expanding on that whole philosophy of
Absolutely.
Bitcoin and disruptive technology, decentralization. That's really cool. It's like a fractal of decentralization.
Yeah, Paul's not going to let me add anything because it's like, well, we're doing the same.
Well, but you know what? If you are doing the same, you can explain it to
more
us.
Choices.
And there's more choices, and there's always different flavors of the same thing.
Exactly.
So, well, Paul, we'll get back to you here in a little bit, but let's talk to Dimitry Rasa of Mycelium. And Dimitry, just tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I've been a coder for about half my life. I started out writing like video games and stuff for a little. What the heck was that?
That's the boxing match.
That was the boxing
match. Gotcha. Well, here's
ready.
Here's my rebuttal to his story. I've been coding about half my life, video games, and like starting from the trash 80s and stuff like that. That kind of peaked when I was a manager for IT manager for McDonald's Corp for a bit, but then the whole .com thing crashed. So I looked at IT as kind of going more overseas, so I decided to switch gears. That decision was partly made for me because I couldn't find an IT job for like 2 years. But in that time while searching, I discovered I was interested in finance. So I got a kind of a finance sales job that kind of taught me a little bit about that, and I ended up doing that. Decided to learn a little more professionally about it. So I got degrees in business finance, global finance, econ, stuff like that. And since then, I've been working as accountant, financial analyst. But throughout this whole time, I was also playing around with video game currencies, like since about 2003 or so, way before Bitcoin.
Do you want to quickly talk about that? Or
I can quickly mention it. Basically, I was, instead of playing the games, I was investing in currencies, like trading. I'm trying to make money off of them, trying investing in businesses that did the same kind of stuff. So like there were video game currencies, but to me, I kind of understood them as digital value. So when I found out about Bitcoin, after one of them kind of went to one of the currencies I played around went to like heck, I pretty much understood that as the exact same thing I was playing with before, but there's no admins, video game admins telling you stop, you can't do that. Which is really awesome. And it was also about the time that I kind of went from being a liberal Democrat to a, I guess, anarcho-capitalist. But
there's no, I guess there better not be an,
yeah,
guess,
yeah, yeah, I'm okay. Pretty much there. Yeah. So
you got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
I gotta start. Well, real quick though, I want to add that too, you know, I used to play this virtual game called Ultima Online, and it wasn't as, it, yeah, yeah, Paul has pointed at me. That's, it was a great game. You know, there's other things like, there was a famous one called Second Life that was even more advanced where you could kind of like, really create the world the way you wanted to. But it's amazing how some of these games would have a real economy. They were virtual games with a virtual economy, but still that virtual economy functioned like a real one and actually became a real one because you could exchange it for real dollars and stuff. And again, that sort of fractal hologram nature of some of this stuff. And I think it's just beautiful that you could actually, I mean, you can learn from that type of stuff. Anyway, it's a cool background.
Yeah, in Second Life, I was doing trading currencies, and that's how I learned about markets and exchanges. And then around that same time, I was going to the university and had the a securities and exchange class like 6 months later, which was effectively a review of the stuff I learned in the video
that's
game.
So that's great. Cool. Yeah. That's so awesome. But anyway, so you learned a lot of that from this kind of investing and trading, mm-hmm, you did with games. You had a degree in it too, correct, in finance, you said?
Yeah, global finance and econ.
Yeah, and then finish up with your background and where you are today.
So I found out about Bitcoin around 2011. Since I had the background in understanding what the heck virtual currencies are, as soon as I found out about it, I just clicked, understood what it was. So I moved my savings into it, which at the time was just a couple of $1,000s. Like pretty much two
add a couple
later.
Zeros to that. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah. Somebody posted, Rick Falkman posted an article that like, I believe in Bitcoin so much, I'm moving all my savings into it. I have no idea how much he had, but I think it was, my guess based on transactions about the same time was maybe like $60,000 or something, but whatever.
Wow.
But I was like, you know, I trusted that much too, so I moved it there, and I've been using it as my savings account for like ever since, for a couple of years. And then about 2 years later, I basically just moved all my finances into Bitcoin.
Smart move.
Yep. And while doing that, I also participated in really a lot in the Bitcoin community, and Mycelium needed somebody with a good reputation and somebody who knows the community, so they hired me as a community manager.
And you were very involved in the forums, you were,
yeah,
telling me. Yeah,
forums, Reddit. I'm probably going to get dislikes for this, but I'm actually one of the treasurers for the Bitcoin Talk forum. So I'm holding Famous's money, too.
You can always go over to Bitcoin.com's forum.
I'm planning on it, yeah.
As a matter of fact, you can go over there and win $1,000 if you can make the most appreciated post on Bitcoin.com.
Actually, ironically, Roger Ver is holding one of my keys. So he's kind of a half treasurer for my money too.
Oh, okay. No, gotcha. And, wow.
So what Paul was just talking about incorporating, you already have, as far as an, mm-hmm, ability to buy Bitcoin through Mycelium.
We do. We have something like local Bitcoin, and our wallet is the different. Like we do most of what Paul's Bitcoin wallet does. Our differentiation is we focus on security and privacy first and then usability. So we're more of an advanced kind of user wallet. So we have support for like multiple types of accounts, single address, multiple address. We have a lot more, like we have features that normal users wouldn't really use, like being able to sign messages with your Bitcoin address to prove that you're the owner of a transaction. And we also try to focus on various features, like third-party support. So we support... the first one we added was our own, which is called Local Trader. Funny thing is, it's called Local Trader, but you won't actually find that name anywhere in the app. It's just a button right on the front screen that says Buy, Sell, Bitcoin. which is basically local Bitcoins, except all the trades are done directly phone to phone. So there's no like local Bitcoin.
Can I purchase 21 million Bitcoins on your wallet?
Yeah, somebody just posted a bug report that if you try to send 21 million Bitcoin exactly, the app crashes, which we never found because we all use millibits and nobody ever tries sending 21 million Bitcoins. But we are pushing it as a feature to make sure that no hackers can just send everybody's Bitcoins to their own wallet.
Can I send 21 million in one?
You could probably try. I don't know if that will actually crash it.
That would crash Bitcoin itself.
Well,
good luck.
I think I would have to actually have the bit.
At least it's true. At least it's not like blockchain info at one point had a bug where they wouldn't actually check whether the transaction is valid. So one of the developers actually sent 21 million Bitcoin transaction to himself.
My blockchain wallet has been down more than one time when I actually wanted to send something.
So he sent 21 million Bitcoins to his own wallet, was a comment on there saying, you guys are screwing around too much. I'm taking back the Bitcoins. Transactions didn't confirm, but it was accepted as a valid transaction.
Wow, that's crazy. Well, you know, I'm just glad that they're the white hat hackers or at least developers or whatever who are willing to point out vulnerabilities, but do so in order to make the system better and to make everyone better off. Because, you know, if they don't get to it first, somebody with worse intentions will, certainly. But
either of you read Justice Ranvier's new deal where he rates the wallets? What do you think of his new wallet report?
There's the privacy.
There's a privacy rating, yeah.
He's rating all of the wallets.
Yeah, we participated in that. We actually had to, AirBitz had to, I think, rate one, and we had to rate one. We couldn't rate it our own. But
I don't think we've necessarily rated any, but there were some people that we know, and you know, they participated independently. I
mean, do you use what he put out there as feedback to improve your
wallet? Well, tell us more on the other side, guys. Yeah. It's actually both of you. And then we'll all get to Tone Vays right after that, too, here on The Crypto Show. So we'll be back in just a couple of minutes. Stay tuned. It's going to be exciting here in New York. All right, guys, welcome back to The Crypto Show. We got another hour. We're in the second half. God, it seems like forever when we're talking to Paul Puey. I'm just kidding.
God, the time just is like molasses when you're talking to me.
Just kidding.
I am jealous of his talking skills, though.
I got him back for making fun of my broken glasses. He did this more than once. Well, actually, many people have done it more than once.
Only because I've had the exact same thing.
That's true. You know what? I shouldn't be so hurt. No, but it sucks. You know, we get here to New York. Danny and I are like exhausted. We find our way. We walk like 20 blocks to where we were staying, and then I lay in my bed and I somehow manage to. I mean, I've laid on my glasses before, but you know they just get a little squished with the whatever it is, the
bricks,
whatever it is. But the where they don't get damaged really permanently. But anyway, I break off one of my. What do you call these things? I don't
know.
It's not important. What air hooks? Whatever. Anyway, I broke my glasses. That's what matters, and I've been wearing them with really crooked, and it's ridiculous.
So whenever you see Chris, just think of Peter Griffin. I don't know what it is about his crooked glasses,
Peter.
But he looks like
Paul. What
Peter
are you
Griffin,
doing,
man?
Paul, what are you doing? Did you just take a picture of me?
You did promise we're gonna do a little bit of video today, so at least we need Paul. A few still frames for. You know, the social media crowd.
Paul, I'm gonna throw you in a vat of liquid nitrogen and then churn you in my ice cream.
Slanted still frames?
Yeah. That was good. That was good. I like that. That was really good, actually. Still frames, camera, glasses. I like that. That was clever. Well, speaking of clever, that was Dimitry Rasa of Mycelium. And Dimitry, you were just telling us about Mycelium, the wallet. Anyway, kind of continue with that.
So you call like there's AirBitz wallet and there's their alternative wallet, Mycelium. And we are kind of the, I guess, alternative wallet for the alternative lifestyle, if you could say that. We focus first on privacy. So for our local trader platform, all the transactions happen between phones. All the communications are encrypted also phone to phone. We have no way of tracking who's trading what. And that's kind of what we try to focus on pretty much everything with our wallet. So any kind of private key transactions, we don't log them, we don't track them. We support Tor connections if you use Android. We also try to add more advanced third-party features. So most recent we've added was Coinapult locks, which allows people to lock the value of their Bitcoin in dollars.
I like that. It's like I think we had the guy on from that. It's like an option, like a financial.
Actually, in this case, I believe they actually traded $4 and keep it on their side.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, Voorhees. Yeah, but Voorhees.
It was Voorhees. That's right. Yeah. Anyway, that's really cool. Yeah, I like how Bitcoin is expanding into some of these derivatives, which aren't inherently bad. They're financial instruments. I mean, your car insurance is a derivative.
Anyway. It's not really a derivative. The dollars are actually sitting in a bank. They're just on the wallet. You see them as a regular Bitcoin address account, and it's just the Bitcoin value doesn't change. We've had something called, if you're in the Eurozone, we've had Cashilla support for a while, where you can actually create an account and send Bitcoins to a a European style, like in here we have, what the hell is the name when we go, ACH? The European style ACH, you can actually send Bitcoin to an ACH style account in Europe and it just converts to dollars and deposits. It's there.
You mean ACH like the draft from a bank account?
Exactly. Like IBAN is what it's called, I think.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah. So like if you want to pay a bill and they have a checking account in Europe, you can just send them Bitcoin and converts it directly from the
That's
wallet.
That's cool.
And then we also have support for hardware devices. So our security is more hardware-based. So we have support for Ledger, for Trezor. Pretty soon we'll have support for Case Wallet and a couple others too.
Real quick, actually, I'm being a little selfish here. Can you explain how Trezor works? Because I'm actually supposed to help someone get Bitcoin off of a Trezor wallet tomorrow into, you know, for instance, a Mycelium or AirBitz wallet. Real quick, do you know how does it work? Do you know?
So you would add an account in Mycelium that's a Trezor account, and it would actually request your Trezor to send it the public version of the HD wallet keys. In a hierarchical different deterministic wallets, like in regular old style wallets, you have the public side and the private side. And the public keys get imported into your account, and you just see your balance as if it was there. But whenever you want to send money, what it would do is you would create a transaction. It would ask you to physically connect Trezor to your phone through USB. Then it would send the transaction to the Trezor. Your Trezor would pop up with a transaction, ask you to verify. If you verified, it would sign it and send it back to your phone.
And you verify physically on the Trezor, right? Yeah, oh, okay. Yeah. So basically your phone it'll prompt it when you connect it, and then you physically manually do it. Okay.
Yeah.
That sounds pretty easy. Okay, cool.
Yeah, it's like very straightforward.
Thanks for helping
me. I can actually demonstrate it after we...
You may have to. Yeah. Thanks for helping me cheat, though.
Sure.
That's cool, because I literally, like, I have this friend whose dad, for her birthday, wants me to, like, set up a Bitcoin wallet easy enough, but then it's on a Trezor, which he doesn't even know how to get it off, and I don't either because I've never used one. But that's helpful. Thank you. Yeah. But anyway, what else about Mycelium? It sounds like a really cool wallet with a lot of good features. Anything else we haven't touched upon?
Well, Mycelium as a company, we're actually focusing on covering the entire Bitcoin infrastructure. So we do have things like Mycelium Gear, which is kind of like BitPay, but the coins go directly to your wallet as opposed to into third party. We are actually rebuilding our wallet to be more of a secure private financial platform as opposed to just a wallet. So we do actually have plans for like other cryptocurrencies and even supporting like dollars and euros and stuff like
that.
Cool. And we have hardware devices out there too. We had the Entropy device, which lets you print paper wallets securely. We're still working on a Bitcoin card. A lot of people have been asking for it. It's basically a full hardware wallet, but it's the size of a credit card.
Cool.
And it's a flexible display, flexible battery, circuit board, stuff like that. It's really cool.
Wait, flexible display? Like there's a visual graphic display?
So there's a display on there.
Cool.
Yeah, it's black and white, but it's the whole
thing. It's a start.
Flexible. Yeah.
It reminds me of, have you ever seen the movie, the Philip K. Dick movie, Minority Report?
Yeah.
Where they have everything is like a graphics display, a video, the newspapers, everything's like paper thin.
Yeah.
That's so cool, the technology is going there.
Definitely. Yeah.
And I even read an article how Corning, the glass maker, is involved in making some of the material for that. And it's like, it's just beautiful. I mean, technology is beautiful, and thank God for the market. Well, anyway, anything else to add about what Mycelium's doing or the wallet?
No, that's it. I mean, our main differentiation is we try to be more for people who want to stay really private with their finances, I guess.
Okay. Well, and so that's what, you know, and that's what's neat is, you know, the tendency in the market is two things that are seemingly paradoxical. One, product differentiation, and two, product imitation or convergence. And the convergence or the imitation obviously implies an intentional replication or copying of someone else, but it doesn't always happen intentionally. A lot of times two separate companies will come up independently with the same idea essentially. And that's cool because the same idea can be implemented in different, subtly different ways that are beneficial for some people more so than others.
Yeah.
And that's just beautiful. But then with product differentiation too, there are going to be certain things that one wallet has that the other one doesn't, and vice versa. And so there's just, I like how there's room for more than one wallet in this market.
Yeah. And as Paul said, there's a balance between privacy, security, and ease of use. So our main differentiation is, I mean, AirBitz is just really winning. I mean, I got to praise them for their ease of use. But because we're focusing on privacy and security, we're going to have to follow different standards. So we can't really use it as easily. So we're
right.
More on an advanced user wallet. Yeah.
And that's not a weakness on your part. That's just like...
It's just a different...
it's inherent into the universe that there's this trade-off between privacy, security, and usability. It's not like, you know, it's a, you know, anyone's failing to code properly or something.
We're basically following a different customer base, I guess, in a way. So we're competing but not completely competing.
Right. And that's what's so cool. And so you know, I think people should look into Mycelium, people should look into AirBitz and determine for themselves which wallet is better for them. And I think there's gonna be... Well, I was getting there. That's why I paused for a second, because then it occurred to me, and you need to let me finish. Oh man, let me hide my stuff in my backpack. What? No, just kidding. What is he talking about?
I have no idea. No.
I'll tell you. I'll just give you a hint. It's the first prime minister of Italy after. Was it the prime minister? That you were telling me about of Italy?
Oh, president.
Or president, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Italy's got an interesting political history.
Inside joke. The first female president.
There was a lot of inside in that joke, yes.
Yes, absolutely. That's what I love about Italy and this show. But, not only is does each wallet, even if they're largely overlapping, they have niche features that are suitable more for certain users than others. But the fact of the matter is you can have both wallets for your personal use. And, you know, maybe you use one for certain things or maybe use the other for others. And so there's no there is competition in a sense, but then there's also not competition.
Do use both.
There you go. That was a very open confession. I appreciate that, Paul.
I use at least five.
I use at least five.
Paul is
of which Mycelium is one. And what I love about the ecosystem is, unlike banks, which are more or less the same, each wallet actually does feel different.
Yes.
And so you actually gain some significant benefit from actually using the different platforms.
Absolutely.
Whereas, you know, a checking account feels like a checking account. Yeah.
I have all of them, but mostly it's just to see what the competitors are doing. But they actually use the AirBitz for at least their business directory and some of the other stuff.
Well, that's great. And I know what you mean. The checking account feels like a checking account. Yeah. All the same, no matter what bank you use. But like the beauty of the technology in Bitcoin and Bitcoin wallets is there's a lot of this nuance to it. And Paul is kind of a slut when it comes to wallets because he uses at least five, he says. So, you know, don't judge him. You know, We're all libertarians here, and we're all live and let live. You do what you want in your private life, Paul. I'm just kidding.
Or my public.
Or public. Well, we're coming to break in a couple minutes. And, you know, I'm really just thrilled, one, to be in New York, two, to have three really intelligent, very friendly, very awesome guys in front of me who do, you know – the thing is, like, Bitcoin would not be anything without people like you guys. I mean, I think the history books will look back, well, maybe not the history books, but the historians will look back and write in the history books decades from now about people like you guys who were pioneers in the development of Bitcoin wallets and other technologies like Mycelium and AirBitz, and Tone Vase and his analysis. And we're going to talk to him actually on the other side of this break. And I've been enjoying myself a little too much when it comes to tangy tangerine and something else that I've mixed with it. I won't tell you what that is. So if I sound a little too
happy, enjoyable.
Oh, thank you. No,
jolly.
Keep going. We're playing free association synonyms for how I
slippery.
Sound. What? You know what I thought of when you said
festive.
That? I thought of, oh, I like festive. I like festive. I thought of a dolphin. I don't know why, like a dolphin skin, like slippery. I don't know if that's endearing or creepy. But
it's meant to be a little both.
And that's the balance of life. It's a little of both. I like that.
I can't
that.
Say so many words on FM radio that I have to say things like slippery and moist.
There you go.
Are we talking
and that's
about
why,
and politicians
that's
again?
Why we need these two guys on our podcast instead of live airing. But we'll be right back on the Crypto Show, guys. All right, guys, welcome back to the Crypto Show here on this lovely October 11th, 2015, a Sunday, here on Logos Radio Network, brought to you, as always, by Brave New Books and Hill Country Home Improvements. And we are coming to you in the aftermath of Liberty Fest NYC, which took place in the heart of Williamsburg, Brooklyn, New York City, New York. And, in fact, we did a live airing of the Crypto Show yesterday from 3 to 5 p.m. Central Standard Time. And we also recorded, I believe, three podcasts of varying lengths, our actually first attempt at doing so. And they were very interesting stuff with Anthem Blanchard of Hyatt Gold and Anthem Vault, which you should check out. And we'll list that or we'll upload that to the SoundCloud. We talked to Nathan Freeman, who is helping out with the Narcopulco. Coming up in February, we'll be at that. And we also talked with Carlos Morales of LibertarianAtheist.com, and he was talking to us about his speech at Liberty Fest about his experience at CPS, a book he wrote about it. I don't remember the name off the top of my head. Of course, you can check our archive for it. But some interesting stuff, as well as his views on religion and atheism, not necessarily shared by me anyway at the Crypto Show, but still we like to have all viewpoints. And then also talked about some other interesting stuff, a very colorful conversation with that guy, and a conversation we could only have had off air because there are certain restrictions on language that were definitely not met by him. But it was a really cool interview. He's a very sharp guy. It was hard keeping up, but not in a bad way. Anyway, we've just been talking to Paul Puey of AirBitz and Dimitry Rasa of Mycelium, and they both gave a very beautiful defense, if you will, of their respective wallets and companies. And the judges have come back with a verdict, and it's a tie. They're both incredibly great wallets. One is not necessarily better than the other in any sort of purely objective sense, and that's how we do it here at the Crypto Show. They're great guys, and of course they're still with us. But we're going to be talking to our other guest, Tone Vays, or Tony Vays, I guess, depending, or Tone, depending on how you want to pronounce it, or perhaps how I'm butchering it. But Tone has been a guest here on the Crypto Show before, and we're glad to have him back for several reasons. One, his time with us was truncated because of some overbooking during that episode. And two, he's very, very sharp, very interesting guy who has a lot to say about Bitcoin and risk and financial analysis and trading analysis with respect to Bitcoin. And three, he is gracious enough to and hospitable enough to let us do the show from his place around New York. And I can't thank him enough. Tone, thank you so much. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having me on the show.
No, thank you for coming back. And we really appreciate it. And actually, let me just give a quick bio, which is off of BraveNewCoin.com. Tone Vays is the head of research at Brave New Coin and is a 10-year Wall Street veteran. His experience revolves around the area of risk analysis and trading. He is a big believer in sound economics and an advocate for personal liberty, freedom, and privacy. You can see more on his personal blog, Liberty Life Trail, and frequent comments on Twitter at tone_LLT. And he is a former contributor to the Cointelegraph. Quite a bio, a lot of experience there. Well, Tone, give us quickly, we briefly touched on your background there, but give us a slightly more in-depth background for yourself.
Some more in-depth background for myself. The financial institutions I've worked at were Bear Stearns, JP Morgan, MSCI and Axioma. MSCI and Axioma, they're more risk-oriented and also do things like indices. And JP Morgan and Bear Stearns. Bear Stearns no longer exists. They were the big investment bank. And JP Morgan kind of does everything in finance, but I was also in on the risk side of that business.
And you were at Bear Stearns, like, what, a year before the financial crisis, I believe you said?
Yeah, I got hired, I believe, in January of 2007. So everything bad started at the end of that year, but 2008 was when Bear Stearns collapsed.
Well, and just, I mean, without going too in depth into that, but what was that like? Was that like crazy for you, like being new in the mix of that, or what?
It was strange because that was also, I was also new to working in that industry. It was strange. I guess I was in a good position because we were a subsidiary of Bear Stearns. So we were a side company owned by Bear Stearns. So we had all our own data, our own servers. Our paychecks said Bear Stearns because they owned us, but we were somewhat independent. And because we were doing risk analysis for hedge funds, we were like, oh, this is great. This is going to bring us a lot of business. So we were a very profitable unit until a lot of these hedge funds started failing. And then it's like, well, if they all fail, we have no one to do risk analysis on.
Right.
So it's like some volatility is good. And but eventually it did catch up to us. We were very profitable in 2008. But then in 2009, there were less hedge funds for us to evaluate.
Right. Well, and that's what's beautiful is that's why I love having you guys on. Y'all are experts in your respective fields, and there's a lot of crossover even there. But, you know, with Dimitry, for instance, he had some of course, he had a degree that touched upon finance and economics, and he had experience from virtual currencies in gaming and the investment and training experience he had there. And you had some hardcore real world experience in that you then transferred over to the Bitcoin realm. And you definitely have some of the most hard hitting analysis out there when it comes to Bitcoin. And so quickly tell us too, how did you find out about Bitcoin?
Oh, wow. I'm going to try and cut this story short. I might be one of the few people that was not introduced to it by any specific person. I just kind of discovered it on my own, just heard it here and there on alternative media, and I Googled it back in 2012, I believe, like early 2012, after hearing that WikiLeaks was now using it to kind of stay afloat when they got cut off from the financial industry.
Which people forget about. People always focus on the Silk Road, but WikiLeaks was doing that too. Yeah, go on. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I try to focus on that when I do my presentations. Like one of the reasons why Bitcoin became popular, because that's what made it popular for me. I wasn't interested in Silk Road. They weren't selling anything there that would interest me. So that never caught my attention. But WikiLeaks definitely caught attention because I was paying attention to what they were doing. And when
do you have something against raw milk?
No, I would. Why?
Asmund here.
That was one of the items on Silk Road.
Oh, okay. No, I have nothing against raw milk, but milk is not something I would be ordering online. So that was
well said. Probably not a good idea to order milk.
when a guy has a cow, he's not ordering milk online, right?
I'm not sure what you mean by that, but anyway.
Udder's on standby.
But yeah, there was just it just never caught my attention. But WikiLeaks caught my attention. And in 2012, I just went to Google. I had a few minutes to kill. But that's the thing. You're working long hours. You're commuting into Manhattan. You're working this finance job. You think you have like one of the greatest jobs in the world. You're making good money. But I Googled it real quick, and all I saw was mining. And I'm like, and I remember saying to myself, possibly out loud, I don't have time for this. I don't have time to like learn all this stuff and just mine for Bitcoin. So I kind of forgot about it. And then in 2013, I started hearing about it some more just through alternative media. And I Googled it again, and all I got was local Bitcoins. And I remember saying to myself, I can just buy this stuff. I can just go out and buy it. And that's what I did. I found someone on local Bitcoins. I met him at a coffee shop. I gave him some money. I got some Bitcoins. But the driving factor that made me go and get it then was because I kind of wanted to bet on some football. And it's difficult
to love football. I've learned this.
I love college football.
And don't get me wrong. I like football too. I used to follow the University of Texas, my alma mater, before they sucked. But you're from graduated from Florida State?
Florida State, yeah. So I'm a big Seminole fan. And they won a championship that year, 2013, the year I finally bought my Bitcoins and the year I wanted to bet on my football team.
See, that's so weird. There's a lot of fate involved in various people's Bitcoin story. Who was it? Like Nathan Friedman, how he moved to Acapulco. Maybe not exactly a Bitcoin-related story, but I love those personal background issues that sort of push people in the right direction. Well, we're coming to break. We're talking to Tone Vays, of Brave New Coin, and we'll actually talk about what Brave New Coin is and some other stuff when we get back on the other side, so stay tuned, guys.
Country Home Improvements. Did your home receive hail or wind damage from the recent storms? Come on, we all know the government caused it with their chemtrails, but good luck getting them to pay for it. Okay, I might be kidding about the chemtrails, but I'm serious about your roof. That's why you have insurance, and Hill Country Home Improvements can handle the claim for you with little to no out-of-pocket expense. And we accept Bitcoin. As a multi-year A-plus member of the Better Business Bureau with zero complaints, you can trust Hill Country Home Improvements to handle your claim and your roof right the first time. Just call 512-992-8745 or go to hillcountryhomeimprovements.com. Mention the crypto show and get $100 off. And we'll donate another $100 to the Logos Radio Network to help continue this programming. So if those out-of-town roofers come knocking, your door should be locking. That's 512-992-8745 or hillcountryhomeimprovements.com. Discounts are based on full roof replacement. May not actually be kidding about chemtrails.
Looking for some truth? You found it. LogosRadioNetwork.com.
I've been walking a tightrope between fact and fiction. Been wrestling with demons in small bottle prisons. Been talking to sinners who claim to be Christian. Been shouting at leaders who claim to be listening. And the pendulum swings from the left to the right. As momentum increases, the need for the fight.
All right, guys, welcome back to the Crypto Show here on this lovely October 11, 2015, a few hours after the completion of the Liberty Fest NYC in the heart of Williamsburg, Brooklyn, New York City, New York. We're very excited to come to you. Twilight Zone moment of that? Oh, that's right. We were doing our live airing yesterday, and that music was our intro music was coming on while Jordan Page was actually singing in real life too. Whoa, it's weird. It's crazy. Anyway, we are talking with Tone Vays of Brave New Coin. He is a risk analyst and trading analyst with much experience on Wall Street, and he's transferred that experience to Bitcoin. And we're going to talk about, a few things, but we're going to talk about Brave New Coin and what that is. But before we do, just wanted to have him complete his story of how he kind of got into Bitcoin. And you were mentioning how you had heard about how WikiLeaks was using it to fund themselves
since they were cut off from access to regular banking. And then, you know, you're a big football fan, Seminoles, Florida State, your alma mater, and how you wanted to bet on them and continue with that.
No, that was pretty much it. And as far as I know, betting on the internet is went down a long time ago, and I'm not even a gambler. I just hate having the state tell me what to do.
Amen.
And I just felt like, you know what? I want to put $10, $20 in a game. I should have the right to do that. And I want to do it in the simplest possible way. And I just read on the internet, well, Bitcoin is the simplest possible way to do it. So that's exactly what I did. And that was, I think that was the final straw that got me to finally making a call, local Bitcoins, and meeting someone. It turned out to be someone that's somewhat popular in the Bitcoin community. I didn't even know at the time. And after I got the Bitcoins, this was during the Cyprus financial crisis in 2013. And I got some Bitcoin. I met the guy a couple of more times. I picked up a few more. And I just sat on him because I didn't know anyone in the Bitcoin community. Nobody. I didn't have time to go to meetups. I didn't even know the community existed. And it would have been at least a year before the New York City Bitcoin Center opened. And that's when I finally walked in there because it happened to be a few blocks away from my job. And then I walked into the Bitcoin Center, met a lot of cool people, attended my first conference. And then I just said to myself, you know what? I got stuff I can talk about. I know the industry well. Became a conference speaker. And when Brave New Coin, I saw me speak at one of the conferences. They invited me to speak in New Zealand where the company's based. And then they offered me a job, and it was something I really liked. I took a huge pay cut and was very happy to leave the financial world.
So what do you think about how Mt. Gox was about $200 or maybe $100 above all of the other exchanges at the time? Do you think that had anything to do with how the price artificially went to 1,000 and 1,200 and so on?
Yeah, yes and no. Mt. Gox was inflating the price. The Willy bot, that's pretty much almost proven.
I mean, if you looked at any of the other exchanges, they're between $100 and $200 lower.
Well, that's also at the time when it was going up. So Mt. Gox was inflating the price, but also the another reason why is because people were paying a premium for Mt. Gox. And then on the other side, it was flipped. So it's hard to explain why, but most likely it's because Mt. Gox was inflating the price. And that's how what they were using to kind of drive more traffic to them, because they were liquidity strapped. They were out of Bitcoins. So they were keeping it artificially high to try and entice more people to go to them in order for them to solve their liquidity problem. But the general rule of thumb is if the majority of exchanges are at one price and one exchange is way off, whether it's higher or lower, you don't want to trust that exchange.
No, I absolutely did not. And when I see Mt. Gox, I'm like, something's fixing to happen with this. And Ben Swan even came out with, well before Mt. Gox crashed, he came out with an article. If you look back and find it, it's called Bitcoin, but Beware Mt. Gox, because he had lost money on Mt. Gox and was warning everybody well ahead of time.
I also remember I saw this video. I forgot who did it, but I saw a video. This would have been probably a good 9 months before Mt. Gox went down. The video came out about 6 months, but the video referenced something else the guy said. Back in like 2012, Mt. Gox had like a little flash where the price literally went to like $1. I think the price was like around 17 or 18 bucks, and it flashed down to a penny for a few seconds. And I saw this on a video. And right after that happened, some guy made a video back in 2012 saying, I saw this go down live. He's like, I believe Mt. Gox was just hacked and they no longer have Bitcoins.
Whoa. Okay.
So, and I saw this video, and the video was shot like back in 2012. And the guy's like, I believe they got hacked for a majority of the Bitcoins. He's like, whatever I have on there now, I will be moving it out. And I saw this video late in 2014, and I was like, wow, somebody called that a long time ago.
Well, before they ran out of actual Bitcoin, one of the reasons that there was a big difference between the Bitcoin price is if you wanted to request to get your dollars out of Mt. Gox, it would take you a very, very long time. But if Bitcoin is not, it's not like locked in the financial system, and they did have a little bit of it. So people are paying a major premium to convert whatever the money they had into Bitcoin and pull the Bitcoin out.
That was precisely what Ben Swan's article was about on when he said, beware of Mt. Gox.
Definitely, yeah.
Is they inflated the price, you know, well above everybody else. So he had tried to get his stuff out. He's like, hey, all right, give me some Bitcoin.
And this actually happened in a couple of other tiny little exchanges. Usually before they all die and just right before they crash, there's a big jump in price because people are trying to move their money into Bitcoin and get it the hell out as fast as they can.
Have you ever heard anything there about a similarity of a price in the missing Bitcoins from Mt. Gox and those that are associated with the Silk Road?
No. What do you mean?
I heard somebody compare them before, that there was a similar price.
Not the price, but the number of coins, you mean?
I heard about it, but...
Well, that's something to be investigated, actually. That's interesting. No, and you're not the first person to mention that there might be a connection between Mt. Gox and the Silk Road and obviously various forms of malfeasance.
For the longest portion of time, Mark Karpeles was actually one of the suspects for Dred Pirate Roberts.
Okay. Yeah, I remember that coming up in the court case, but that was kind of thrown out.
But
they ignored it, unfortunately.
Mt. Gox was the really only exchange. The other ones were really tiny for a while, so it wouldn't be surprising that a lot of their coins were going between them.
See, and that's an avenue for investigation. I'm sure eventually someone will uncover the story behind that, because we don't know for sure. I can't imagine, though, that there isn't some connection between Mt. Gox and various activities on the Silk Road, and the fact that Mark Capellas was involved in Mt. Gox and alleged to have been involved in the Silk Road. And that's not been proven, but I think he likely was. So I think there's something to that. But, you know, as Tone was saying, that's a very general, a good general principle is that, you know, when various exchanges are within a rough trading range and one exchange is way off, that's a reason to be suspect of that that one exchange. There's analogs in various other parts of finance where I remember reading an article about a guy who was running a Ponzi scheme, and he was offering like 2 or 3% on CDs above the average market rate. And whenever you see something like that, where there's, you know, significant deviation from the market average, that's a reason to be suspect. Well, let's switch gears, Tone, and, we got about a minute left till break, and I want to talk about, you know, your market analysis. I want to talk about Brave New Coin. I guess real quick in this minute before break, tell us real quick, what is Brave New Coin?
Sure. So Brave New Coin, we're a data company, and really. So what we're doing, we want to gear towards something like the Bloomberg of the cryptocurrency space. So we have contacts with all of these Bitcoin exchanges, and we're trying to get all the data, and we're storing it. And there's a lot of things we can do with that data. One of the things we're about to release is a Bitcoin index. I know a lot of people have Bitcoin indices out, but we've spent a lot of time working on ours. And I came in to help them put it together with the spec, and it's about to be released. It would be updating every 30 seconds. It would be using approximately 8 to 10 exchanges with some proprietary formulas.
We'll talk more about that on the other side of the break on the Crypto Show. Stay tuned, guys.
The magic word is wallet. W-A-L-L-E-T. Wallet.
Sweet.
right, guys, welcome back to the final segment of the Crypto Show here on this lovely Sunday, October 11th, 2015, here in New York City, brought to you by Logos Radio Network and Brave New Books and Hill Country Home Improvements. We're talking to Tone Vays, risk analyst, Bitcoin analyst, all-around expert on the movements of Bitcoin. And we were just talking about Brave New Coin and the Bitcoin index that they are coming out with. And what exactly are that they it has yet to be come out with, the Bitcoin index?
It's in testing right now. The formula set, we're looking at it live. We want to make sure that if one exchange spikes one way or the other, it properly adjusts through the whole index, because I've seen it on other indices. I don't want to name names. Where one exchange spikes, and then if you're using the wallet, because we would like our index to be used in wallets, like AirBitz, like Mycelium, but they're already using it. They're already using our older one, but this one should be significantly better, and we're hoping that it would become the standard throughout the industry. So that's what we're aiming for. So that's one of the products we're coming out with.
And so just to clarify, when you say index, you're talking about an index of all the different market exchanges for the price of Bitcoin.
Correct.
And what is the advantage of this index for investors or people with Bitcoin?
Well, it will show it will have some stability on the small level, because if you're using just a single exchange and it so happens that when you want to make a transaction, right then and there, somebody made a big buy of Bitcoin or a big sell of Bitcoin, one exchange would go down, but there's really nothing happening in Bitcoin as a whole. It wasn't any news, it was just one buyer. So this is where an exchange can quickly spike higher and lower, and then within a few minutes it comes back to default because there's arbitrage between other people. That's actually one of the issues with Bitcoin that the stock market doesn't really have, and this is one of the things I usually say at events, in that when you look at a stock like Apple, it pretty much trades on the NASDAQ exchange. And then you have things like Interactive Brokers and Fidelity and Ameritrade. They're just brokers. They're not exchanges. They're places for you to buy Apple stock, Microsoft stock, IBM stock, but that's trading on one exchange with one pool of liquidity, which is why you need a gigantic buyer to move that market. In the Bitcoin space, the broker is the exchange. So imagine if some illiquid stock that can't even make the S&P 500, and all the shares of that stock are broken out based on all these brokers, and then you don't know what the true price is because they're completely independent.
So you're basically creating the index is essentially creating a single broad market.
Correct.
That covers all of these different markets.
Yes, and we're focusing on the more liquid, more trusted exchanges, and that would adjust because exchanges come and go. I'm actually glad Mt. Gox is no longer around, and I still thank Mt. Gox for bringing Bitcoin to the world, because
for
if
sure.
it wasn't for Mt. Gox, there would be no original price. There would be no way to really trade it.
Thank you, Magic the Gathering.
Yes. And another thing I always say about Gox, this is where regulation will always be late, in that the regulators are still talking about, we need to have regulation so that there won't be another Mt. Gox. There won't be another Mt. Gox, because this is why bad companies fail.
Yes.
And then
great point.
And all these other exchanges are not doing what Mt. Gox was doing. They
learn from it.
Of course.
And people learn from it. Their customers learn from
it. Which is why regulation is always late.
If it's too good to be true, like the price, then it's obvious.
Yeah.
Then it probably is. Yeah. Very good point.
Don't
say
that. Bitcoin is great.
No, I'm talking about the price swing on Mt. Gox versus the rest of the real exchanges.
Like Bitcoin compared to all the real money.
And real quick, because I want to get into some of your risk analysis and other things, but I want to touch back on that video you saw where the guy saw in real time the price drop on Mt. Gox of Bitcoin to a penny, and you really believe, as he believed, that that was maybe the instant in which they got hacked?
I don't know.
Well, we can't know
possible.
For sure.
We can't know for sure, but that is possible.
And we don't know who hacked it, because
right.
One thing that people sort of don't want to believe in a way, I think, is that the people behind the exchange could have done the hacking themselves and acted as if it was an external threat. Right. We just don't know.
Right. And that's one of the things with Bitcoin and especially with markets, like a gambling site, a site similar to Silk Road, the new ones, is that when they get too popular, when they have a lot of Bitcoin on there, the admins of that site now have to make a choice. Do we want to just run away with this Bitcoin, or do we want to continue to be the trusted standard? And the gambling companies face the same thing, especially when the owners of the company are anonymous.
I've seen exactly the opposite on those flashes where it went up to 2,000 and more on Mt. Gox.
Those I haven't seen.
You've never seen? I've seen it where it actually went for just a minute or two to 2,000 and 2,500.
Well, I guess let's just take, for the sake of argument, the fact that it happened. What do you think would explain that, perhaps?
I've actually seen those more recently on some of the other exchanges. You would get like a trade at $1,000. What do I think is happening there? Or when it drops really low? I don't want to accuse anyone. What I think is happening is you would have a bot and you're just like screwing some users where someone throws in a limit order and you can time these limit orders and someone is like just trying to, you know what, like just get me out of here and I want to sell. And then the exchange just manually throws in a price and somebody gets a really good deal.
Huh.
Which is why I never recommend anyone on a not so trusted exchange to put in market orders. You want to put in limit orders. And the Bitcoin space is still not there yet. One of the things that I always say, people are like, oh, do you trade Bitcoin? And my answer is, I only trade like a little bit of Bitcoin just so I know what it's like. Because honestly, I traded real markets and I still trade real markets. And this is not even the minor leagues. Like none of these exchanges compare to the tools and the ability of a real financial exchange in the finance world. So the tools are just not there yet.
What was the recent deal with Cripsy where there was a big deal about they were going to get sued or something?
Yeah, so Cripsy is in a bit of a trouble because they actually managed, I didn't even know that was possible. Cripsy actually managed to unite almost every regulatory agency, and they're all just going after Cripsy. Because there was a whole article about it, like multiple agencies are going to get them on multiple things. They didn't like their KYC, which they didn't really even have. Just some of the conversions that they do between currencies. There's a lot, and a lot of these companies, I just feel the regulatory hammer is about to come down. The SEC, in my opinion, is just going to go after anyone that issued a token.
Well, what do you feel about exchanges like Shapeshift, and are those going to have some of the issues that Cripsies have being like all crypto and little amount of KYC?
I think Shapeshift is also going to have a lot of legal issues.
Well, we got less than 4 minutes left, and what we're going to do is we may see if everyone wants to do a podcast briefly afterward to get some of the more stuff, some bonus stuff. But I want to talk to Tone Vays about some of his analytics and what he's done. Just tell us about some of your risk and trading analytics, and you've been very successful. And the thing is, I want to make it clear, no one is 100% successful, but the best traders like you are successful a vast majority of the time. Anyway, talk to us about that.
So I started doing a trader's report. It's similar to a newsletter. We have a report on Brave New Coin. It was free for a little while. It is now subscription-based, and it's on a weekly basis. And most of it is I talk about the news, all the important news in the Bitcoin space and how it relates to the price. And then I also talk about technical analysis because that's one of my specialties is trading based on candlesticks and chart patterns, more mathematical. And I have a degree in mathematics. I also have a degree in financial engineering. So it kind of gives me a good insight.
What is a candlestick real quick? And then what do you see, in the near term for Bitcoin as far as technical analysis?
A candlestick is basically a way to represent in one shape, The close, the high, the low, and the open price for that time period, whether the time period is a day, an hour, a minute, or a week. That can all be represented by a candlestick, which is how traders, technical traders, read charts.
So, and basically, like the bottom of the candlestick on the left is the close, or no, or
well, it depends on the color. If the color is white, that means the price opened at the bottom and closed at the top. If the color is red, that means the price opened at the top and it traded down during the day and it closed.
This is above me. We're going to talk about more of this in the podcast if everyone wants to do that. But tell us about the near-term prospects for Bitcoin and the price.
I thought that Bitcoin bottomed this summer. I expected Bitcoin to bottom this summer. I did expect Bitcoin to bottom at a lower level. I thought it was going to go down to the low hundreds, like 110, 120. It never did. And I did think we reversed around the time of Greece. Right now, I'm waiting it out right now. If Bitcoin stabilizes above 250, I think we're going to keep going up. If it goes down to under 200, I think it'll be a really tough start to 2016.
Well, we got about a minute left, and we've been talking with Tone Vase.
What about the halving? What do you think Bitcoin will do at the halving?
I don't think Bitcoin will do much at the halving. Last time there was a halving, no one knew what to expect. It was an event. I remember people thinking, is Bitcoin still going to work? Is it still going to exist?
And what is the halving? You mean
the reward gets cut in half.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
You can also say inflation gets cut in half.
And this time around, it will be totally priced in.
Excellent. Tone Vase of Brave New Coin. And, of course, check out his personal blog, Liberty Life Trail. Smart guy, right the vast majority of the time when it comes to technical analysis, not just in the normal financial world, but in the financial world of Bitcoin, which, of course, is a burgeoning brave new world, if you will. Anyway, we've had Paul Puey of AirBitz and Dimitry Murashchik of Mycelium, and we might have a podcast. We'll see you next time, guys, on the Crypto Show.